La Iglesia Bautista Universitaria comprende el poder que el lenguaje posee para sea limitar, sea ampliar nuestro entendimiento y experiencia de Dios. Mientras que no cambiamos cada lectura ni himno en nuestra misa, sí que intentamos equilibrar referencias culturales, tanto como de género, para incluir a todas las personas en la adoración de Dios. Siéntese libre de emplear lenguaje inclusivo durante la misa.
Good morning. My name is Sarah Harrington Jones. I serve as Associate Pastor for University Baptist Church of Starkville, Mississippi. I serve alongside Reverend Bert Montgomery. A few weeks ago, our leadership team made the prudent decision to go back online for services during the Christmas season and to remain online during January. With the spread of COVID and flu and many among us who are at risk, we invite you to join us online for the next few weeks to continue to wear your masks and be distant and look after your neighbor. Today, we welcome you to worship at University Baptist Church. If you've just now joined us or are not familiar with our church, we're a little eclectic. But especially when we meet together online, we hope that we carve out some time for you to be centered, for you to hear a word from God, something that touches your heart or challenges you. And so we are here, and we are glad that you are here. To learn more about University Baptist Church, visit our website, www.ubcstarkville.org. Again, we invite you to worship with us this morning.
Baptized in water, sealed by the Spirit, cleansed by the blood of Christ our King. Trusting his promise, faithfully now God's praises we sing. Baptized in water, sealed by the Spirit. how God's praises we sing. Baptized in water, sealed by the Spirit, marked with the signs of Christ our King. Born with the Father, we are His children. Joyfully now God's praises we sing.
Good morning. Evening, perhaps. Good evening. Or I think it's morning for you. Anyway, welcome to UBC. I'm Eli Pope, and I'll ask you to join us in prayers today. Lord, thank you for this time together. Even though we are remote, even though we are spread out away from each other, we still have each other, and we still have you, as we always have had. Lord, thank you for being there for us. Lord, I ask for your blessings. I ask for a blessing on those who are sick, who are afflicted, who are in the hospital, who are having to try to recuperate at home, who have no time to recuperate at home and must return to work. Lord, bless us and heal us as only you can. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for those who serve, for those who do the work of healing, for those who serve our country and our world and our state and our cities. Lord, I thank you for the nurses, for the firefighters, for the politicians, for those who stand on the front lines and those who stand in the back. We all have a part to play. And thank you for those who play their part. Lord, I thank you for your salvation. I thank you for the baptism in your Spirit that you sent to us, for the metaphorical dove that lights on each of our heads, for your love and your care in bringing us closer to you. Lord, hear our prayer. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, UBC family. My name is Catherine Hintz, and I am reading from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 3, verses 15 through 16 and 21 through 22, from the New Egalitarian Translation. As I read from this holy scripture, listen for God's word for you. The people were full of anticipation, wondering in their hearts if John might be the Messiah. John answered them all, saying, "I am baptizing you in water, but someone is coming who is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not fit to untie. This one will baptize you in the Holy Spirit and in fire." When all the people were baptized, Jesus also came to be baptized, and while Jesus was praying, the skies opened and the Holy Spirit descended on the Anointed One in visible form like a dove. A voice from heaven said, You are my own, my beloved. On you my favor rests. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I have a quote from the great Swiss psychiatrist Carl Jung taped to my wall. It reads, "Life really does begin at 40. Until then, you're just doing research." Now, I'm going to be 54 this year. Jung's quote really does resonate with me as I reflect on my life's journey. But sometimes I wonder if Jesus reflected on such experiences in his journey. Our scripture text today that Catherine just read for us comes from the Gospel of Luke. Jesus is 30, not 40, but 30 years old, and he's going with a crowd of others down to the river to be baptized, and yes, down to the river to also pray. Other than the birth narratives found in only two of the four Gospels, we really don't know much about Jesus before his baptism. Matthew's Gospel does record that the Holy Family sought refuge, political refuge, in Egypt for just a few years when Jesus was little. Luke does include one story about Jesus as a 12-year-old getting lost for 3 days in Jerusalem. Otherwise, well, lost according to his parents. Otherwise, though, as far as the four Gospel writers are concerned, really everything begins for Jesus at 30. The minister and writer Melissa Bain Severe, suggests that the writers don't talk much about Jesus' first 30 years because maybe Jesus' first 30 years were not all that different from any of ours. Jesus learned to read and write. Jesus played with, and probably fought with, his brothers and sisters. He made friends. He laughed so hard until his gut hurt. He hurt so bad until he cried. Naturally, he learned from his father the skills of being a carpenter. And like all of us, Jesus probably dreamed about things that might be. He imagined his future and pictured the various paths that he could choose to take. Maybe it is fair to say that for those first 30 years, Jesus was just doing his research. Now, without a doubt, as it still does for us, some of that research involved for Jesus learning to distinguish God's voice from all the other voices in his life. He carries into the river with him the voices of his parents and his friends and the rabbis and the culture and so much more. He carries their expectations, their hopes, their fears, their warnings, their judgment, their guilt, their shame. All the do's and the don'ts, they carry all these voices that they have poured upon Jesus. He carries with those voices into the river with him. And when Jesus comes up out of the water, the Spirit of God comes down like a dove upon him. And then a voice from heaven affirms, "Yes, Jesus, you are the Son of God." A voice from heaven affirms, "Yes, Jesus, you are in the right place. You're following the path that you were called to walk. Yes, 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 Jesus, you are deeply and completely loved by God." Jesus was immersed in the river, and Jesus was immersed in the yes of God. I once baptized a young woman in rural Kentucky. She carried with her into the baptismal waters countless voices which sought to drown out the voice of God. Stacy was tormented by schizophrenia. Dark, sinister, evil spirits reigned in her thoughts. Pictures on her wall screamed, like Harry Potter pictures could talk and move in, you know, Harry Potter movies. Pictures on her wall moved and screamed at her, yelling obscenities at her. Voices in her head accused her of being solely responsible for Jesus's violent death. Stacy often called to talk to me about such things. Once, three or four deacons joined me, and we went together to her home, where we sat and listened to her and saw some of the paintings and pictures around, and we prayed for her. She kept asking over and over and over again, did we really think that God could love her? Did we really think, did we really, truly, not lying to her, but really believe that Jesus did not hate her? Yes, we assured her. Yes, we assured her time and time again. Yes, Stacy, yes, yes, 1,000 times, yes. And eventually, over some time, she began to ask about baptism. If all these things that we kept assuring her were true, then could she, even her, could she be baptized? After a little discussion and a whole lot of prayer, the deacons and I planned a private afternoon baptism service just for Stacy. She stepped into the church baptistry and joined me waist deep there in the water. And she professed Jesus to be her Lord, and I cupped my hands and I poured the water over her head 3 times in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And then those of us, the few of us that were gathered there for this private service, but we were there as witnesses, we all affirmed together in a responsive reading that yes, in fact, Stacy was a child of God, that she was fully and completely loved by God through Jesus Christ, her Lord. And Stacy, dripping wet from her head down to her toes, began to step out of the baptistry, immersed in water and immersed in the overflowing yes of God's love for her. As a Christian minister, I want to be clear. I am a firm believer in Jesus and prayer, and also in psychology and psychiatry. Don't forget, I began a sermon by quoting Carl Jung. I believe that when working with illnesses of the mind, prayers and Jesus can and should include God's good gift of psychiatric medicine and well-trained quality counseling. I hear those amens out there. I do not pretend that Stacy's baptism cured her of schizophrenia or any other mental illness. I'm not saying it couldn't or didn't or that God couldn't do that. I don't pretend to think that it did. I do know, however, as the church historian Glenn Henson explains, that one of the major concerns of the earliest Christians in the first century was that baptism provide hope, give hope to people who were groveling in the fear of demons and ridden with terrifying anxiety about their fate, about their sin, about their guilt, about death. I do not know what became of Stacy, but I do know that in the rest of my time in that small rural town, Stacy never returned to the church to ask questions. She never called me again, concerned about demonic voices telling her that she was despised by Christ and hated by God. Somewhere between the world-changing significance of Jesus' baptism in the River Jordan and the exorcist-like drama of Stacy's baptism in a rural Kentucky church, somewhere between those things is where you and I find our baptisms. Whatever else baptism may mean, a symbol of our commitment to following in the way of Jesus Christ, of repenting of our sins, washing away of our sins through Jesus' death and resurrection, dying to our own life, old life, and rising again to a new life in Christ, the welcoming of new Christians into our family of faith, whatever else baptism may mean. Perhaps at the heart of it all is that we are carrying with us all the voices in our heads, all the voices in our culture, all the voices in our families and friends, all the voices in our hearts. We are carrying all these voices with us into the river, the deep river of the divine, until we are immersed in the yes, yes, 1,000 times yes of Christ's love without limits, until we are affirmed that yes, 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 we are beloved children of God. To paraphrase Jung, maybe life really does begin with a yes immersion, and until then, we're all just doing research.
Good morning. This is the time in our service where we remind you and encourage you to give to our congregation and to the Lord's work in Starkville. If you've been watching television lately, you've seen a lot of solicitations on behalf of animals, dogs and cats, and they show puppies and kittens out in the snow and cold trying to make you feel guilty to give. I suggested that our pastors, Bert and Sarah, sit in the snow this past weekend and take a video of them looking pitiful, but that's not really the way we want to approach things. And the vision team nixed that idea anyway. So what I want to do is encourage you to support the Lord's work in Starkville by giving to University Baptist Church. Remember that University Baptist, besides paying for our facilities and our pastors, we give to Habitat for Humanity and the work it does in Starkville, and we give to support Starkville Strong and all the work that it does for the people in Starkville. We also contribute to the Baptist Seminary of Kentucky, which educated both of our pastors, and we give to the Cooperative Baptist Fellowship in our state and on a global scale. If you are encouraged to give, and if you can give, we ask that you contact our church. Click on the donate button on our website, and it will give you instructions on that. Thank you for all that you do. Thank you for the work that you do for University Baptist all the time. And now, if you would, pray with me. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you that we can always trust in you. You are an abundant God, and out of your great mercy, you have given us so much. We give you these offerings today, and with them we worship you. May our gifts be a blessing to many. We pray this through Christ, your loving Son, who gave his life for the sake of the world. Amen.
As I went down to the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, could the Lord show me the way? Oh, sisters, let's go down, come on down. Oh, sisters, let's go down, down to the river to pray. As I went down to the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, could the Lord show me the way? Oh, brothers, let's go down, come on down. Oh, brothers, let's go down, down to the river to pray. As I went down to the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, could the Lord show me the way? Oh, brothers, let's go down, come on down. Oh, fathers, let's go down, down to the river to pray. As I went down to the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, mothers, let's go down to come on down. Come on, mothers, let's go down, down to the river to pray. As I went down to the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sinners, let's go down, come on down. Come on, sinners, let's go down, down to the river to pray. As I went down to the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Good Lord, show me the way. Good Lord, show me the way.
Thank you for choosing to worship God with us this morning. We invite you to visit our website following this service. It's ubcstarkville.org. Take a look around, get to know who we are, and see what the mischievous Spirit of God is up to in our midst and doing in our fellowship. And if you have any questions about this service, about faith in general, about following in the way of Christ, maybe even about being baptized, please go to the Contact Us link there on the homepage and send us a message. My co-pastor, Sarah Harrington Jones, and I would love to hear from you. Remember that we are online through January, and we encourage you, if you haven't yet, to get vaccinated and boosted. And for the love of your neighbor, and for the love of all the overwhelmed medical professionals out there, please practice social distancing through this surge and keep wearing your mask properly. And now, as we begin a new week filled with new opportunities and new worries, may the overflowing, life-giving love of God, our Creator, wash over you and refresh you. May the wild and mischievous Holy Spirit strengthen you and guide you as you walk these days in the way of Jesus, our living Lord. Amen.
And they'll know we are Christians by our love, yes, they'll know.